Stay together and follow me. What was that? The king of the jungle.
The lion.
That's right. Come, let's see what he looks like. My, isn't he ferocious to look at? I'm glad he's inside that cage. Do you know? He's a member of the cat family. The male African lion has a mane which is not found on the Indian lion.
What's a mane, ma'am?
It's the long hair on the neck of the lion. And do you know why it is called the king of the jungle? Because it's the most ferocious animal of the jungle. And most animals are scared of him.
Tiger! Tiger! Tiger!
Aha! You can recognize the tiger. They are also members of the cat family. As you can see, they have stripes on them. They are very dangerous when they are hungry. And usually, old or wounded tigers are known to attack villages where they can find easy prey in cattle and human beings. And once they are man-eaters, they are very dangerous and have to be killed. Like the tiger, there is another animal from the cat family called the leopard. What's it called?
Leopard.
Yes. It has spots on it and it's smaller in size. Found both in Asia and Africa, the leopard is a known hunter. Another animal spotted like the leopard is the cheetah, found in Africa, but it's taller in size and known to be one of the fastest animals on land.
Ma'am, look, there's the elephant.
Yes, children. Do you know the elephants are the largest animals living on land? See its big trunk. Like we use our hands, the elephant uses its trunk, with which it can break a branch and even pick up an apple and put it into its mouth. The African elephant has larger tusks and ears than its Indian cousins. And so, they are easily recognizable. In areas like forests, where trucks and cranes cannot be used, elephants prove invaluable, as they are able to lift heavy loads and move with ease and assurance. The elephant's tusk is also very valuable and is used for making jewelry and objects of art. Oh! That's the elephant's way of speaking. And it's called trumpeting.
Ma'am, can't we have a ride on an elephant?
Not today, my dear. We have a lot more to see. We'll do that another day, okay? Now, what do we have here in the open cage?
Giraffe!
Oh, very good. The giraffe, you can see, is a very tall animal and comes sometimes up to the second floor of a building.
Ma'am, then the giraffe can eat leaves directly from a tree?
Yes, and when they have to graze off the ground, they have to spread their forelegs wide apart so that their head can reach the ground. They have a yellow skin with dark patches, and when they stand among trees, they're not easily visible. What do we have here in the shallow pond? Let me see the board. Ah, it is the hippo. Short for hippopotamus.
Hippopotam.
Yes, you can call it the hippo. This is the third largest mammal after the whale and the elephant. Here is a big word you will learn. A-N-P-H-I-B-I-A-N. Amphibian. What's it?
Amphibian.
Yes, which means that it sleeps submerged in fresh water, lakes or rivers, with only its nostrils above water.
To breathe?
Yes, to breathe. At nightfall, it emerges on dry land and grazes on green plants. They have a large appetite, and if kept in the zoo like this, it has to be fed a lot of fodder to be satisfied.
Ma'am, isn't that a rhino?
Yes, let's go around and see it closely. Yes. Yes, it is a rhino, short for rhinoceros. Its main feature is its single horn right above his mouth. This horn or tusk has a lot of medicinal value. And this animal has a bad eyesight.
He should wear specs.
Yes, if only he could. Alas, he also has a weak intellect and gets easily irritated. He is 15 feet long and 6 feet high, and his sense of smell is very sharp. And since he cannot see well, he will charge at you blindly at the slightest provocation.
Let's run, boss!
Don't be silly. It's behind the cage.
All right. Now move on. What's in the next enclosure?
The kangaroo.
Yes, the kangaroo. Kangaroo is one of the strangest and oldest species of animals on earth today. Its homeland is Australia. And it's a marsupial. Now, what is a marsupial? It's an animal with a pouch. Understand?
Yes, ma'am.
A full-grown kangaroo stands 6 feet tall. A kangaroo, when born, is not more than 1 inch in length. Isn't that strange?
Yes.
And it grows 6 feet tall. Its front legs are short and its hind legs are very long. These powerful hind legs enable the kangaroo to take long jumps of 3 to 5 meters. Can you imagine what is 5 meters? It's a big distance. It has a thick long tail also. It uses it to rest and balance itself while jumping. The female kangaroo has a pouch in its belly and it keeps its young ones till they grow up. It has no difficulty in jumping with the baby in its pouch. And it's a meek animal, and its power of smelling and hearing is quite strong. Now, what's this in the next enclosure?
Camels.
Yes, the ship of the desert. And do you know why it is called so?
No, ma'am.
Okay, I'll tell you. It is because it has broad feet and hence it can walk comfortably in the desert. Have you tried walking in sand? It's most uncomfortable. The camel also has another interesting feature. It can do without water for many days. This is so because they can store it in the hump on their back. And this, I'm sure you all know, is the horse. Not all zoos keep this animal. Just like cows and bullocks, they are trained to work and they have been used by human beings for many, many years. They are used for drawing carriages and load and riding and so on.
Like in the races, ma'am?
Yes. Those are the best breed of horses and they're looked after very specially. The equestrian events find a place in the Olympic Games also.
What is equestrian, ma'am?
Equestrian means any sports dealing with horses, like riding, jumping, and so on.
I'm going to learn riding.
That'll be very nice. And now, on to the next enclosure. This animal is the...
Zebra.
Right you are. Did you know he's a cousin of the horse? And found in Africa. It is easily recognizable by its black and white stripes.
Like a zebra crossing on the road?
Yes, it's derived the name from this animal. And don't ever try touching the zebra. It is a very stubborn, savage and untamable animal. Come on, next enclosure.
Ma'am, is this the wild boar?
No, it is the bison. It is not found in our country, but in the prairies of North America. There were millions of them before the settlers came to America. They were killed for food by the Red Indians and for their skin by the white settlers. This animal is wild and they move about in large herds. All right, now move on or we'll be late to reach school on time.
Ma'am, there doesn't seem to be any animal in this wide area behind the fence.
That's not possible. Look carefully.
I can see some horns.
Oh yes, there they are, the deer. They are very majestic looking and extremely fleet-footed. They usually move around in herds and used to be hunted for its meat and skin. Almost all countries in the world have banned the hunting of deer.
It is so beautiful and timid. I would like to have it as a pet.
Yes, that's a lovely thought. The next cage here has bears. There used to be many bears in the world long ago, but because they used to steal sheep from pens, they were hunted and killed. Bears usually feed on grass, berries and nuts. Sometimes they scavenge the remains of dead animals. During the winters, bears hibernate in caves or under fallen trees. They love honey.
Ma'am, I also love it on bread.
Good. It's healthy, isn't it? As I was saying, bears unhesitatingly steal honey from beehives, as the bee stings do not hurt their thick skins.
Ma'am, I've seen bears in the circus.
And I've seen them doing shows on the street.
Yes, you seem to know a lot about bears. And what have we here? Goats. These are short, hairy mammals which usually have two curved horns on their head. They are very agile on the hilly slopes and they eat grass and leaves. They are kept for milking. Ah, isn't their bleating nice to hear?
Ma'am, my grandmother has some goats in her house, but I don't like the taste of its milk. Ugh.
You're not used to the taste of that milk. And then there are the sheep, which are not kept in the zoo here. They also give milk and their meat is eaten in some countries. But their main value for human beings is its wool. Australia is the largest wool producing country in the world. And what do we make from wool?
Sweaters and carpets.
Good. On to the next enclosure. Oh, there's an artificial pond in there. And what are these long and ugly reptiles called?
Crocodiles.
That's right, crocodiles. These are the only large surviving reptiles of the bygone ages. They are dry land animals and breathe through their lungs. They spend a lot of time in the water, where they live on fish and flesh of animals and human beings.
Ugh!
Yes. In the rivers of the deep jungles of Africa, you find them floating like dead logs of wood. And they get many innocent victims who mistake them for the log of wood. They are nocturnal hunters, that is, night hunters, and come out of the water at night for their prey.
Ma'am, look, so many turtles here.
Oh yes, these are harmless reptiles, unlike the crocodile. It uses its hard shell for protection when faced with some danger by putting its head and legs within the shell. They move very slowly on land and can be easily caught, but in water they are good swimmers. You can keep one as a pet too. And these are clusters of cages closed on all sides. I wonder why.
It has snakes in them.
Ha! Scared, Booby. I'm not afraid of them.
They look so creepy.
Yes, they do. They're really creepy. They're legless reptiles that crawl on the ground with the help of their scales. There are many poisonous snakes which inject poison into their victim with the help of their fangs. Fangs are their two teeth in front. The cobra is one of the most poisonous snakes. And then there are the non-poisonous snakes who crush their victims with the help of their coiled bodies. Can you name one such snake?
A python.
Yes, that was clever of you. Snake skin is of great value for making bags, wallets, belts and so on.
My mother has a purse like that.
Ah, that's nice. And now to the next cage. This is the chameleon. It's a reptile from the lizard family and it can change its colors according to its surroundings so as to camouflage itself against enemies. The ordinary garden lizards have claws to assist them in climbing trees, but the house lizard has suction cups on its toes to assist its climbing walls and walking on the ceiling. All right, let's move to the next cage. Aha! It has the cunning fox in it. This animal is a member of the canine family and has a very sharp sense of sight, smell and hearing. It is a very distrustful animal and an untamable creature. It's also a very beautiful animal. and has a large bushy tail. It feeds on mice, hares, pheasants and rabbits.
Gosh, what a lot of noise is coming from those cages.
Can't you guess, silly? They are monkeys. You are a big monkey.
Oh, naughty of you. Now that's enough. You know we human beings are descendants of monkeys, don't you? In many ways, our behavior is quite similar to them. They live in trees and swing from one branch to another by using their limbs. They are protective towards their young ones and carry them slung under their body until they are old enough to fend for themselves.
Mom, what do they eat?
They eat leaves and berries. Be nice to them. They don't like being teased. And this cage seems to have chimpanzees. They are huge and live in large nests built on trees. Isn't that strange?
Yes,
chimpanzees living in nests? They use their longer forelimbs for jumping from tree to tree, but their hind limbs are quite weak. Chimpanzees grow faster than human beings, and by 6 to 8 years of age, they are full-grown adults. Well, I think we have done a full tour of the animal section of the zoo. Before we go over to the birds, we must not forget to say something about the domestic animals. Can you name some children?
Dog, cat, pigs, cows.
Yes. Now let me tell you a little about each of these animals. Let's take the dog. What sound does it make?
It barks like this.
Woo, 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 woo. Ah, you are a good mimic. Yes, the dog is the most commonly seen domestic animal. They are kept as pets and can be easily trained. They are faithful to their master. Some dogs are specially trained by the police to help them in smelling the trail of thieves. Firemen also take their help to rescue victims. Dogs are mammals of the canine family, so called because of their large canine teeth. Can you name some breeds?
Alsatian, Cocker Spaniel, Pekingese, Labrador, Apsar, Doberman.
Ah, you know quite a few dogs' names. And the other domestic animal favorite among little girls is the...
Cat.
Yes. And what sound does it make?
It mews like this.
Meow, 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 meow.
Fantastic. They are kept as pets in the house. They are very agile and can climb trees. They can fall from great heights and yet not get hurt as they fall on their feet. And another very useful domestic animal is the cow. The male bullock is the backbone of the Indian villages. It is used in drawing plows in the fields, and the bullock cart is still a means of transport in the villages. The cow gives us milk too. You all must be having milk every day.
Yes, ma'am.
I love milk.
Ugh, I hate milk.
There you go again. Now, whether you like it or not, we have to move on to the aviary.
What is an aviary?
That is a place for keeping birds. What's it? An aviary.
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 Yes. So, let's go.
Ma'am, what about the donkey?
Oh, yes, we've forgotten an important animal, haven't we? The donkey is a beast of all work and is used for drawing carts, drawing logs, as a pack animal, and for any other odd job. They are very stubborn, but bear their weight very, very patiently. As we walk along to the aviary, let's talk about birds in general. Of all branches of wildlife, birds are the most popular because they are beautiful to look at and are seen during the day rather than at night, as are the other animals. A bird is a feathered animal and its bone structure is adapted to flying.
How is that, ma'am?
Birds' bones are hollow and hence it lessens its weight and helps it to fly. And birds live in?
Nests.
That's right. Their nests differ from one bird to another. They are made of twigs, mud, leaves, grass and any other obtainable material. These nests are either on branches or in hollows of trees. Some birds even build their nests in roofs of houses, in tall grass on the ground, or in holes in the cliffs. Every year, migratory birds undertake long journeys. In winter, birds living in places with cold climate fly south to places with warmer climate. They have a very strong sense of direction and are able to find their destination without any difficulty. Now let me tell you about the common birds like the sparrows and the crows, whom you will not find caged in the aviary. The sparrow is the most common bird you can find anywhere. It is small built and nests in trees or any nook or cranny it can find. They are even seen nesting in lamps and beams or in roofs. They can adapt themselves to the surrounding conditions very easily, and that explains their presence all over the world. They are considered to be pests as they eat grain, fruit buds, and drive away helpful insect-eating birds. The crow is another very common bird. Its sound is very, very familiar.
It's like this.
Yes, and it's quite an irritating sound when it goes on and on and on, isn't it? Crows are large black and dark grey birds. They are scavengers.
What is a scavenger, ma'am?
A scavenger is an animal feeding on dirt and refuse from the streets. The crow also is one such bird and eats any rubbish he finds. They also have a bad habit of stealing the eggs of other birds. They also sit on these eggs and hatch them. And on hatching, they bring up the young birds as if they were its own. So you can see, it's a very cunning bird. A very strange behavior of the crow is that they flock together on the death of another crow and are known to attack people in the vicinity by diving and pecking at them. Some crows migrate in winters.
Does that mean they go to warmer plains?
Yes, you're right. There, now we have reached the bird section of the zoo. They have divided the water birds from the others and kept them in this artificial pond.
Oh, look, ma'am, they have even made a little island with some trees on it.
Yes, I'm sure they would also like to dry up on land every now and then.
Oh, the water looks so cool. I wish I could join them in swimming.
You would be pecked and attacked. The whole place is full of birds.
There are so many of them and they're making such a din. It's almost like a classroom full of kids and no teacher. Yes, that's right. Now let's see if you can identify some of them.
I can see lots of ducks.
And I can spot a seagull.
Oh, I can see the swans. And me, I can see the kingfisher.
And there are some pelicans too. Those ones there with a pouch under their beak. Now let's take them up one by one and I'll tell you a little about each of them. Let's begin with the duck. They are webbed-footed water birds with very characteristic bills. They are kept as domestic animals in some countries, but unlike hens, they often fly away. They are migratory birds and always move together in large flocks, even over the oceans. They fly as high as 16,000 feet during these migratory flights. Those larger birds there who look like ducks are the geese. And what is one of these called?
A goose.
Right. Geese also have webbed feet to help them while swimming. Like the ducks, geese are also migratory birds and usually fly in large V formations. V-shaped. You understand?
Yes, ma'am.
Did you know that domestication of geese was done by the ancient Egyptians and Romans? The Romans especially favored the geese because in their war with the Gauls, the geese, on being disturbed by the Gaul soldiers, silently creeping up on the Roman camps, would start honking loudly. Honking is the sound made by the geese. Thus warned by the geese, the Romans had enough time to repel the attack of the Gaul soldiers.
Ma'am, can't we use them ever now?
Well, we'll have to ask our army. And now, these domestic geese are prized for their flesh, eggs and soft feathers. The geese from Siberia migrate to India during the winters there and hence are required to fly over the Himalayas. They have been found to fly at heights of 27,000 feet where the temperature is very low and the air also rarefied, which means it's less dense. And those beautiful looking large white water birds with black beaks are the swans. Haven't you heard the simile, as graceful as a swan?
Yes, ma'am.
Well, these swans are very graceful in flight and even while swimming. The black swan is found in Australia and the black-necked swan in South America. And now to the seagulls. These birds are found in most coastal areas and they stay near the shore where the fish are in plenty. They're usually white with black markings on its back and have yellow beaks. It is again a scavenger bird and besides fish, they eat almost anything that is edible, including small marine animals left by the tide. They also are plunderers, as they swallow eggs and eat up baby birds.
Oh, how cruel!
Yes, that's the way of nature. And now, those birds with the long beaks are the kingfishers. They are fish-eating birds and with the help of its long beak, they catch small fish, water insects, small frogs and tadpoles. Let me tell you of the legend of how the kingfisher got its colors. Long, long ago, a kingfisher wanted to reach the sun and its underparts got burnt, hence giving them a brown color, and its back got the blue color of the sky.
Is it true, ma'am?
It's only a legend, silly.
Ah, those tall and elegant birds with sharp bills are the herons. These herons live on the banks of a river or a lake. And yet, they build their nests on the nearby trees. Isn't that strange? You can easily spot the large, untidy nest of the herons high up in the trees. You can hear them calling out to each other, and their sound is very harsh, like clank! A very interesting feature about this bird is that both the male and the female incubate the eggs.
What is incubate, ma'am?
Incubate means to hatch the eggs. So the male and the female heron take turns to sit on the eggs till they are ready to hatch. And those birds there with a pouch under their beaks are the pelicans. They are also large water birds with webbed feet. They store the fish they have hunted in the pouch. Though pelicans are good flyers, they do not wander too far away from the shores on which they breed. Have we missed out on any of the water birds we see here? Those huge birds standing in the water on one leg are the storks. They also sleep standing. Isn't that funny? They have long beaks to catch fish and thin long legs. They are also migratory birds. And those black ones there with yellow markings on their head and a white breast, what are they?
The penguins.
Correct. These are large but non-flying birds. They live in cold regions where the temperature falls as low as 40 degrees centigrade. And the velocity of the wind is 60 miles an hour. Penguins are found in colonies or large gatherings and crowd together with their backs to the wind to protect themselves as best as they can. The largest and most impressive of all penguins are the emperor penguins. They are over 3 feet in height and weigh up to 80 pounds. As penguins cannot fly, they migrate by swimming. They can even walk on their feet like people, but they walk very slowly. When surprised, they lie on their stomach and slide on the snow, propelling themselves with their small wings. Penguins are agile swimmers in the water. They catch fish and squids. And with that, we have covered most of the known water birds. Now let's move on. This seems to be a large clearing behind the cage. Some big bird must be kept here.
Ma'am, look there on the tree. It's the peacock.
And there's one there near the bushes.
Ah, yes, the majestic bird, the peacock. Do you know that it is the national bird of our country?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, and they are metallic blue in color with a crown of feathers on their head. Peacocks have long tail feathers, which they spread out like a fan around them. These long feathers have bright, colorful eyes. But the female peacock, or the peahen, does not have these majestic feathers and looks quite ordinary in comparison. The white peacock is another species of peacocks and is quite rare.
Ma'am, don't they spread their wings and dance when it is about to rain?
That's what my grandmother used to tell me also. But they do so to attract the female during the mating season. They also have a beautiful sound, and you can hear their voice echoing from somewhere deep in the woods. We'll hear it in a little while, I'm sure. And now, let's move on. The next cage here has the ostrich. They are the largest birds in the world. And an adult bird weighs approximately 220 pounds. They are incapable of flying and have long, powerful legs, and it can run at a speed of 50 miles an hour for about half a mile. They swallow any bright and shiny object within reach of its beak. Did you know that the size of an ostrich egg is 20 times that of a hen's egg?
Gosh, ma'am, that big.
Yes, that big. And over to the next cage. Here is another big bird. It's had for the great Christmas dinner in many countries in the world. What is it?
A turkey.
That's right. The domestic turkey is a native of America. And at one time, it used to be a wild bird. Turkeys were used by Red Indians for meat, and their feathers were used for making headgear, blankets, and robes. You can see they are large, bulky birds with red faces and necks. What's in the next cage?
Ma'am, we can see something in the corner up there.
Ah, yes, it's an owl. And as you all know, the owl is a night bird. They are awake all night and hunting for their prey, and they sleep through the day. There are usually two kinds of owls, the ordinary or the little owl, which is about 9 inches long, and the eagle owl, which is 2.5 feet tall and found in many parts of Europe. These ones you see here are little owls.
Ma'am, I can see one there in that box, but his eyes are closed.
Yes, they have a big head with large golden brown eyes and a short and strong curved beak. Their feathers are silky, and this enables them to glide silently. Did you know owls glided silently? Their hearing and eyesight is very well developed. And did you know, they even have eyelashes, unlike other birds. And though they have a smaller field of vision than daytime birds, They have the advantage of being able to turn their head through almost a complete circle.
And what do they eat, ma'am?
Owls are big birds of prey, which means they hunt for their food like the hawks and the eagles. They feed on mice, rats and voles, and even small birds and insects, and they swallow them wholly. I think you know a lot about the owls. And now to the next cage. This cage has the vultures, who are also scavengers like the crows. They are large birds and look very graceful in flight, but ugly when they are on the ground. They have feathered necks, and this makes them look awful. They play an important part in cleaning up dead animals. If they were left untouched, they would decay and pollute the area. They are helped in their jobs by the kites, which are smaller than vultures and have a better eyesight. The hawks, the eagles, and the vultures all belong to one family.
I don't like them. They frighten me.
Yes, sure they do. All right. Let's go on to see some beautiful birds. What does this cage have here?
It says here that it's a pheasant.
The pheasant? Yes, that's one of the most beautiful birds you can ever see. A cock pheasant, especially in spring, when its feathers are at their best and with the sun rays on it. You see gorgeous colors. The body feathers are burnished copper with browns and purples. The neck is a metallic green and the head has red wattles. It's quite a big bird with a long tail and flies off with a whirr of its wings if you go near it.
I've seen one in my garden.
Surely you must have. It would be very nice if you all started watching and recognizing birds when you were out playing in your garden. You'll really enjoy it. The next cage here has the mischievous magpie. It's a naughty bird in the sense it will pick up bright objects and hide them. Did you know some pet magpies even hide the jewelry of their ladies? The wild ones in the forest steal food from fields, especially acorns. When they have had enough, they bury them in safe places to be eaten later. As you can see, they are small and black with some white feathers near the wings. The jay also is a naughty bird having all these characteristics, but they are more brown in color. And what are all these very tiny and brilliantly colored birds with long beaks?
The hummingbirds. It's written here.
Yes, the hummingbirds. These birds suck nectars from flowers and they drink up about twice their weight in nectar daily. A very interesting feature of these birds is that they can remain stationary in flight by flapping its wings.
Like a helicopter, ma'am.
Yes, that's clever of you. And look at these nests in the next cage. They are made by weaver birds. Just look at the shape of the nest. It's like a bottle with the entrance hanging towards the ground. This prevents snakes from entering the nest. They usually build these nests in groups, so you can find many nests dangling from one tree. The next cage here has another interesting bird, the tailor bird. See how small they are, with thin and sharp beaks. They make their nest as neatly as a tailor.
Oh, but they don't have a sewing machine.
Yes, that's a joke. But they stitch with their beaks. They make the outer walls of their nest with leaves, which they sew together with grass. The inside of the nest is lined with grass and twigs.
Oh, look, ma'am, parrots.
Yes. These large colorful ones are called parrots and the smaller green ones with a red beak are the parakeets. They are very popular for their gift of speaking and you find them as pets in many houses. The large African grey parrot was the first noticed for speaking.
Ma'am, what do parrots eat?
Parrots have fruits, nuts and seeds. And did you know that some parrots have a lifespan of over 100 years?
Gosh, I can't believe it.
And then there are the swallows. You must have seen them sometime. They are black in color with a tail that has two long points. They are clever birds and good hunters. They are of great help to the farmer because they eat pests like locusts, mosquitoes, flies and other insects. Well, we've had a lovely time at the zoo, don't you think so?
Yes, ma'am.